Okay. Last time we had this set up as an amplifier, single stage BJT amplifier, and it didn't work real good. Because the current limitations of this device, I'm sorry about the glare. There's hardly anything I can do about that. So, but I titled the video power amplifier, but it didn't really give us any power. So, power amplifier don't really have to be loud. What makes it a power amplifier versus a signal amplifier is that using this device, you're actually driving the final element, whatever that happens to be. In our case, that's a speaker. So the current that's running through this device is actually running through the final element, this signal transformer, which then induces the current into here. So when we take, what we're going to do is add another stage to this, which is not going to be a BJT, it's going to be a MOSFET. And then we're going to move all this over there where the MOSFET is going to drive. At that point, this is no longer going to be a power amplifier. This is going to be a signal amplifier, which feeds the final stage of MOSFET, which is going to be the power amplifier, because the MOSFET is going to drive the final. As far as I can understand, that's basically the difference between a power amp and a signal amplifier. If this device is not driving your final element, then it's a signal amplifier or a voltage amplifier. But whatever stage is actually driving your final element, that's the power amplifier. So let me redraw this and we come back to it. Okay, so this is the new circuit where we have stage one and stage two. And this is the coupling capacitor between the two stages. And this is the coupling capacitor between the input and the first stage. Reason we need coupling capacitors is because we don't need any DC offset coming from here. We want only the changing. So let's say there's a changing AC signal, but it's riding on a 5 volt DC offset. You know, let's say it's a half a volt signal peak. So it's going down to 4.5 volt, going up to 5.5 volt, and the middle of it is 5 volts. So that's that 5 volt DC offset. So what, if that's coming in here, what you'll see coming out the other side of this is around the 0 volt line, you'll go plus 5 volt, plus 0.5 volts, minus 0.5 volts, plus 0. So it'll take that DC completely out of there, feed only the AC. How that happened, maybe I'll make another video about that. But that's what the capacitors do. So here, you obviously, when you have a resistance here, you have some voltage that's here that's part of the total 24. So, but then this changing signal will change this voltage. And what happens is what goes past that C2 is only the change. And it's going to be around the 0 volt axis. So let's say this thing is biased exactly in the middle where you have, without any input here, you have exactly 12 volts here. So when this input comes, sinusoidal, this is going to have a voltage change, but it's going to be around that 12 volt line, where the middle of the sinusoid is going to be 12 volts. And let's say it changes 2 volts and 2 volts. So it'll go 14 volts, 10 volts, 14 volts. But then once it goes past the C2, it'll be plus 2 volts, minus 2 volts. So AC is the only thing going to the... that wasn't part of my planned talk, but what the hell. I made the video a couple minutes longer. So I just basically biased this guy to have 50 milliamps roughly. That's well within, it's a 200 milliamp limit. So it doesn't, because the only thing what we're seeing here, there's absolutely no use for this current. Only thing we need is the changing voltage across this. So when this signal changes, the internal resistance of this guy changes, gets bigger and smaller, so you get a voltage across there that's bigger and smaller, according to the input. And that's really all we're looking for. How much current flows through this guy doesn't really matter. So I just picked the arbitrary value, 50 milliamps. That gives me 0.5 milliamps here, so I had to get a 47K. Luckily, I had a 47K in my resistor box. And then, so this thing, if you put a 470 ohm, if you do the calculation, 470 ohm divided, 24 volts divided by 470 ohms, that gives me about 24 divided by 470 gives me about 51 milliamps. So now, but this guy has a beta of 100 and we're biasing this as 0.5 milliamps. So the current in this leg is gonna be 50 milliamps, there's about. So, but this resistor is going to allow 51, but now this is going to be the limiting factor where when it doesn't have any input here, you're going to see, you know, about 50 milliamps going through here, even though the resistor is going to allow 51. So those are just rough values to kind of bias this thing in the middle. And then when you see this input change, you'll see this voltage change, it'll transfer over here. And here is the real interesting part where there's no current flow this way as there is in this one. This is a BJT, that's a MOSFET. FET, MOSFET, the last three words is a field effect transistor. What that means is this is like a capacitor right here. It's like this, where this is for DC current, this is an open circuit. There's no current flow through there. So this makes a nice voltage divider biasing scheme because you have no current flow this way, so you don't have to worry about this leg. This is an open circuit right here. So only thing is you have to build a voltage on here. So for a very short amount of time, like microseconds or milliseconds, there is some current flow this way, but once that plate charges, that gate plate, once it charges fully to this available voltage, there's no more current in that way. So it's just this voltage divider. And as this voltage comes in higher or lower, it adds or takes away from that. And that's what causes the current in this one to go higher or lower. And then the rest of it is the same as the last time, where the current going higher and lower through this coil induces the same thing in the secondary coil, which runs the speaker. So why this? If you look at the data sheet on this one, it requires about 4.1 volts here to get it to start conducting. But the thing is, you can't really calculate a hard value for this one because they're not exact, and then, you know, you can't just find that exact value in the resistor box or even if you have to buy them commercially. So, and then this thing is really fidgety. It's either all the way on or all the way off. So a lot of times these MOSFETs are used for switching purposes because they're really fast switches. When you're dealing with megahertz and things like that, when you need the stuff to come on and off really quick, like in computer circuits, they use MOSFETs. So this is kind of a wrong choice for this kind of continuous operation. But next one, and this one's not perfect either, so I'm gonna be improving it more. And next one, I'm gonna use the Darlington pair. Darlington pair is like two of these guys, one small signal, one beefy one, but both of them in one package. So you only have, so it's like this guy and then another guy put together. I'll have to draw the Darlington pair schematic diagram in a different video. But yeah, then it'll act a lot better. But here, I got this, so I put my meter over here. put my voltmeter over there. And got it to read 12 volts. So the reason why I got a 49K and 10K, because I had the 49 in there. And then if you're gonna plot according to the voltage divider, if you're gonna want 4.1 volts here, you have to have 4.1 and the rest of it across here of the 24 volts. So, you know, 19.9 or something up here. So basically, what I did is if you got a 49K there, it's gonna require like a 8.3K ohm here. So if you got an 8.3K, use the 8.333K ohm, then using the ohm, the voltage divider formula, it tells you that you're gonna get 49K plus 1 over this times 8.333K times 24 gives you, okay. So basically it requires something like 8, and I had a 10K potentiometer that's a, you know, tremor potentiometer. So I figure, okay, well that's gonna be perfect. I'm gonna put my, so there's 24 volts available from here to here. I'm gonna turn it on, put my meter there, and I'm gonna adjust this guy until I get 12 volts across there. That means this is exactly in the middle of its load line. Because remember, load lines go like this, where this is V across, that's gonna be, when there's no gate voltage and this is an open circuit, all of it is right here, 24 volts. And when this thing is conducting fully, acting like a solid wire, there's no voltage across here because this is the same as that. So the 12 is in the middle, and then whatever current happens to be, this thing was, I don't really need to calculate the current, but whatever that is, the coil resistance RCVIR, right? And then I is V divided by R. So it's going to be 24 volts available divided by resistance of the coil. That's how much current, milliamps, is going to be available here. But the middle of it is going to be right there. So if you just put your voltmeter there and you adjust this guy, because the voltage across here is the gate voltage. So you adjust it until that reads 12 volts or exactly half of your supply, then you know it's right in the middle of that load line. So it's got this whole area that it could swing as you add more current, or add more voltage or decrease voltage. So that's how I set that up. Let's go look at it. And then let's see if we can get a little bit better performance than last time. Okay, so this is the same exact setup. So here's the first stage. Let me grab a screwdriver. This is the first stage right there. Ooh, I got some hair or something on there. Some cobwebs. Okay, so this is the first stage. This is the capacitor between the second stage, and this is the MOSFET. So that's the second stage. And to bias it, here's the top 49K resistor. And this is the trimmer. That's the variable. So all those give a biasing voltage to the gate, and then whatever's on the collector of that BJT, the top leg, so that capacitor basically takes that signal and brings it over to the gate of the second stage. And then this is the collector current resistor, the 470 that goes to the top of the of this BJT, and then this is the biasing one that goes to the base. See, I don't know if you can tell, the middle pin on that BJT is right there. So that's that resistor that goes to the base, and then that blue wire is just ground. So this is our first capacitor, which goes to the base of the BJT from this input that's going to be coming from this guy. So that red wire, follow it all the way, goes boom, input to the first stage through the capacitor. And this is the voltage amplifier now. Second capacitor, power amplifier. How power amplifier? Because it's driving this transformer. Because the red wire goes straight from 24 volts to one side of the, and then the other side of the transformer comes straight to the MOSFET transistor, and then the other side of it is just grounded. So whatever current goes through the MOSFET goes through the primary coil. And that primary coil goes to the secondary coil right here, which is the red and the green, which come to the speakers. So let's fire this baby up. Okay, just for a review, this is my little jack that goes in the phone. The first capacitor goes into the base of the BJT, and then you have this resistor that also goes through the base. Then you have the second resistor that goes from 24 to the collector, and then after the emitter is just grounded. So that's what makes this signal go straight. So there's no actual wire here on the actual circuit. So these wires are just legs of the capacitor, because it's this close enough where I just have the capacitor connecting the collector and then the gate of that guy. And then we've seen the 49K fixed resistor and the white knob blue variable potentiometer right here. Those two guys go in series to form the voltage divider, biasing voltage for this gate. And you've seen this red wire going to the coil, primary coil, and then I think like the yellowish wire going to the drain, and then the source is just grounded. So everything, all the current that goes through the drain to source circuit goes through that coil. So that makes this a power amplifier, makes this a voltage amplifier, because all you're sensing is the voltage here. You're not driving anything. Let's fire it up. One thing I forgot to point out, it's kind of funny. I don't know if I'm going to be able to show it, but there's that little knife multi-tool keychain thing sitting, and it's touching the back of the MOSFET. That's actually there for a reason. That's providing a little bit of a heat sink, because that MOSFET was getting really hot, and I had this thing just laying by, and I just put it behind it, just barely touching it, and apparently that's enough of a heat sink for that MOSFET to be okay. But sometimes it moves away, so I have to push it back next to it. See, like that, it moved away. So I have to push it next to it again. See, it's touching the MOSFET again. That's kind of ghetto heat sink. All right, moment of truth. I'm gonna turn it on. Boom. Plug in my Luke Bryan song and hit play. It's easy to overdrive these things. See, I don't know if you can hear those distortions. That's when the MOSFET is hitting the two sides of the load line. Either going up, it's hitting the maximum current it can do, or it's doing the maximum voltage that it can go across. So basically, I'm giving it too much input that it's hitting the rails on the output. So I need to pull back on the input, and that'll fix the audio. So I'm gonna pull back on the input. So basically, only time it plays good is if I just have one, like there's nothing hit there, and then there you go. Just on the first stage. Because even if I go to the second or the third, I can hear a little bit. Actually, no. On the third stage of this volume, I'm already starting to hear the distortion that the MOSFET's hitting the rails. So there you go. That's not too bad. So now, only thing wrong is I don't hear any bass. It's all treble. So that means one of those capacitors put together with the resistors, somehow forming a high pass filter, and I'll have to do another video about filters. And that's what we use, is capacitors and inductors and resistors. So one of those combined circuits is producing a high pass filter. That means only high frequencies pass through, low frequencies do not pass through. So even though I'm getting all the frequencies coming out of here, what's going through our two stages is just the high frequency. So that's why out of the speaker, the only thing we hear is treble, no bass, because bass is low frequency. So I'm gonna figure out what's going on, probably use bigger capacitors, and we're gonna further improve that design that's on the board there. What song is this? So there's that. The way we have, let me turn this down. The way we have those things biased, it makes them real unstable. But I did that on purpose, because I wanted those circuits to be as simple as possible while still working. See, they're working. But we need to make those biasing schemes a little bit more complicated to make them stable. And I'll make another video as to why they're not stable now. It's called thermal runaway. We have no way to prevent that. So as the transistor heats up, its internal junction temperature heats up, it starts to conduct more with the same biasing. So as you play, you know, what your biasing calculations show, that's not exactly what all the numbers look like when you actually test it. They're a little off or a lot off because the junction temperature inside the transistor, as it gets warmer and warmer, its characteristics change. And so we need more robust biasing schemes. And I'll have to cover that in the next video. This one seems to be long enough for now. Okay, good night.